Okay, we're in motion now. We're good to go.
Yeah, you're good.
Okay, so the first thing I'm going to be doing is just separating the top from the bottom, just to make it easier to work. Starting from just the recession point on the top of his head, right here, and bringing it all the way around, making sure I just have a nice clean parting to work with. And I feel like the longer time you take just with sectioning out the hair and prepping the haircut, the easier it makes it in the long run. I'm gonna do the same thing on the other side, right here. And just meet up with the point I created in the back. And a lot of the times when I'm doing this, I'm just looking for where the hair would naturally pretty much separate. So I always try to make micro adjustments. And right there is perfect. If you guys have any questions about the haircut as I'm going through it, just, you know, feel free to ask away. So now that we got this separated and out the way, I'm gonna begin working on the size of the head first. And pretty much all I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna create a diagonal parting just to start out. Just like that. See, nice. Okay. And then from here, I'm just gonna extend it down to his face, and just cut off whatever's sticking out.
Your elbow. You just gotta shift a little bit. There we go.
Just gonna cut out whatever's sticking out.
There you go. Perfect.
And that is going to be the guide for my, like, for the whole entire haircut.
And why are you working lower elevation on that?
The main reason I'm doing that is just to really follow, like, the natural contours of his head.
Okay.
And I don't want to have too much volume in the haircut, at least on the sides. In the top, I may change that depending on whatever I say would, like, suit him the best.
Okay. And Blanca's asking, why would you section a V instead of round?
So the main reason I did that was because I was mainly going off of the natural like hair growth pattern in the back of his head. Like if you tilt your head back a little bit. So if you look at it, everything is pretty much flowing in like a really natural direction of where it wants to go. And a good way to really tell is that when you section it out, no hair is like sticking out or pointing in the other direction. Everything is just falling very naturally.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And I, a lot of times, will keep the crown out anyways, separated from what I'm doing on the top, because I just feel like I'm going to cut the top different than I'm going to cut the crown. And the crown has so many different variables, like how it can shift and move, that I personally like to leave that out as well.
And as I'm just working down in my sections, you may notice I'm cutting the hair like a little bit shorter. And that's really just to taper in the sides and the back in this area so it flows smoother and there's not too much weight and buildup right here. And it really follows like the natural lines of his head. And as I'm going in right here, no. As I'm going in right here, you just see me following the natural contours of his head. Instead of cutting out like this and creating more weight and just texture within the haircut, I'm really bringing it in and tapering in this section of the haircut. And all that is kind of really preference and figuring out like what your client likes. Like most people that don't cut hair won't really know or understand how to really say that. You got to look out for keywords that they say, like, oh, I want less hair towards the back, or I don't want the back looking so bulky or square. You got to kind of look out for keywords that they may say to kind of correlate with what they want in the haircut.
It's a great question. Are you over directing each new section to the previous? Is that kind of how it's working? Like 2-1, 3-2, that kind of thing?
I am, in a sense, over directing, but I'm trying to minimize how much
weight
I over direct, because the more you over direct, the more weight you create in the haircut. Sure. And for me, I don't want to create too much weight within this haircut. I really want to keep it more naturally flowing.
So you might not take section 2 all the way to 1. You might.
Yeah.
Depending correct. On the density, right?
Correct. I'm mainly looking for my guide, and then from there, following it and creating the shape in the haircut that I'm looking for. And the right amount of volume in those areas.
Sweet.
And if you look already, like, you kind of see how right here is a lot smoother and there's nothing really sticking out. It just blends smoothly down into it compared to up here. It's a lot heavier. It's a lot more weight.
That's another reason why I leave that crown area out, because I tend to, depending on the client, but I'll build more weight in that crown area. So I kind of, as I'm working up the head shape, I let the head shape kind of play into the to what I'm doing anyways.
And then from here, if you see, I'm just looking for my guide. I could see it right there. That's where I previously cut, and I'm just following that and elevating it very naturally, like 90 degrees off the head. That way I don't create too much weight and have just enough just to really create some shape in the haircut. And if you notice, every time I do the like cutting portion, I always comb it just to make sure everything is still laying smooth and there's not too much weight within the cuts I made. And when we get to this portion of the crown right here, I'm going to start switching my sections to this direction, because we're going to be working on the left side of his head versus the right side. Just a little heads up. And right here is where we really get into the crown. So depending on how I elevate it and how I cut it, it's going to have different effects. So let's say I over-directed this way all the way over here and cut on the line right here. I'm going to create a lot of weight here. If I'm doing more of a natural line and pulling it straight out the head right here, I reduce all that weight in that area. So I'm going to come somewhat in the middle of a very natural line.
You just shift a little bit.
I'm going to come somewhat in the middle of a very natural line and a very soft line, and just look for my guide right there and cut accordingly. And the main reason I'm doing this is because I want to give the crown area a decent amount of weight, but not too much. I don't want it to be overwhelming. And then I double check. I make sure it falls a lot smoother than before. Before, you would notice there's a lot more hair and it's coming out instead of just going smoothly into it. And then this is going to be the last section I create in this direction. After this, I'm going to be working in this direction. So I'm just going to pull it out. Look for that previous guide right there. And one more thing I didn't mention, as I'm going down, the shape I'm creating is more tapered on this angle, because I know in this area I'm just going to blend into it with my clippers. So I just want to make that as easy as possible. That's why I'm going in at this angle.
Are you just using water, or you use tonic water?
I'm using a mixture of water and conditioner. Okay. It makes it a lot easier to work with the hair. And I've tried tonic before. I like it. But I just feel like conditioner is a lot more convenient to find. Like, you always have conditioner around.
True.
So now, as I pull out, you see I'm working in this direction. And the same principle applies. The more I over-direct it this way, the more weight I'll create in the area. And the more I over-direct it towards me, the more I'll be reducing the weight in that area. And making sure you have really clean and parallel sections makes the haircut come out a lot easier and a lot more consistent all the way through. I try to really be patient when creating my sections and not rush it. If I feel like it's not straight or really parallel with what I previously made, I'll just adjust accordingly. You guys go so you can see a better angle. And one thing to really keep in mind as you're working, I would say really pay attention to the angles of your fingers. The angles of your fingers is what really creates the shape in the haircut. So wherever you're pulling out the hair to, 90% of the time that's where the hair would really when you start styling it. So if I pull it out to here, I'm creating this shape within this small portion where my fingers are. The only thing that really affects that is calyx and growth patterns. That's why I say 90% of the time. Right here, this will be my last section on the side before I start working on the top. So now when it comes to the top of his head, I really like to work in three main sections. But first, I'm going to start by separating it straight down the middle.
Ryan, you want to move him just a little bit over?
Move a little bit more to the right. Yeah, right there.
That's good.
Once I have a nice clean line down the middle, this line is pretty straight, but it's not necessarily always going to be. I always follow from the growth pattern in the back right here. So wherever someone's hair would kind of split in the front and get that line. Sometimes it's going to be really straight. Sometimes it's not. And then I'm going to separate the back from the apex of the head down to his ears. Just comb the hair back. The main reason I'm combing the hair back is because I know with this hairstyle, I'm going to be styling it in a backwards direction. So I want to work with that style. And now from here, you could work in many different ways for today. And instead of making small sections, I'm just going to make one section. Well, not really a section, but pull out the hair together and try to create, tilt your head forward a little bit and then to the right. When I pull out his hair, I'm gonna try to cut it at a 45 degree angle. That way I have some weight in the back, but it's not gonna be like heavy in the back. And as I pull it out, you can see my guide from where I cut is right here. And then I'm just going to connect it following that line. Then I'll comb his hair back. And I see one piece sticking out right here that I missed. So I'll just kind of comb out his hair. Cut it sticking out right there. It's always clean. And repeat that same process on the opposite side.
Let's see if we can decipher this question. So with a V section on top, how do you do a haircut like short on the sides, long on top, or side part kind of haircuts?
With a V section on the top,
how do you do a haircut like short on the sides, long on the top? Or I really think this part probably makes the most sense in that question is, how do you do with the side part kind of cut? Like if you were going to do that V section, how would you do it with the side part? I have an answer. What's your answer?
So with that, I would just section out whichever part, I would section out where you're parting the hair and then just eliminate that from the equation of the V section.
Agreed.
Yeah. That way you're not really, with that hair, you could kind of take care of that later and blend it with the sides or tackle it however you want it, depending if you want to leave it longer, shorter, really up to what you feel like the client would like best.
Yeah. I agree with that. And then I think I'm kind of understanding. So short on the sides, longer on top, you could either blend it. I think the V section works for that. I don't see where that would be a challenge. You would just blend the sides or you disconnect the sides, however you want to do it. And if you have a side part, I would have the parting I would just know where the parting is, even though I would still do the V section. I wouldn't, or I would section the V section asymmetrically.
Yeah.
On the haircut. So I would just kind of determine how I wanted to shift the weight.
And typically if I was doing this on a comb over, right? Let's say he's sectioning out his part from just right here, right? That's where he wants his part. From here, I know all this is going to be cut on the sides. And then from here, I'll still take it from the apex and crown. And work with it this way. Just like that. That way, you know... Oh, let me turn. Okay, yeah.
Is that good?
Yeah, that's better. That way, this is the part that's being sectioned out. You know that. And you could blend it into the sides many ways. You could just pull out the hair horizontally. You could do it with vertical sections if you want. Whatever you kind of see fit. And then this section right here, you just have to attack this the same way I attacked it before. You could pull it all up. Like that and cut it, or you could split it in half and cut two halves. It all depends on how you want to really tackle that haircut.
Yeah.
And with haircutting, like I would also say, like, you know, there's many systems, there's many ways, like everyone tackles a haircut, everyone has their own methods to it. But it doesn't mean you have to use that method for every single haircut. Like, even for me, this is like my primary method for doing this style of haircut, but it's not my only method. Sometimes I want to switch it up a little bit and do something different. And now I'm moving on towards the front of his head. So all this is cut on the sides and the back. Now I'm just worrying about the front. And to me, that's the most important part because that's A, the part someone sees every day, and B, like, that part of the haircut really dictates the style of the haircut. And for him, I know he's brushing it back and I know he's keeping it a little bit longer. So I'm just going to pull out the hair and create a triangle shape until I meet the hair in the front. So if I cut a triangular shape, I know as long as I meet this point right here, I'm not really going to take off too much length in the front, which is the main thing that he's seeing. So it might seem like he got a haircut, but when he looks in the mirror, it's like not that much hair has been cut off. And that's really important to keep in mind, depending if someone tells you, you know, I just want to take off a little bit off or a lot off. The main important thing to stay focused on when they say that is really the front. And a lot of the times when it looks like a lot of hair is being taken off, once you dry it, you start to realize, like, wow, I really didn't cut anything. And that might not always be the case because everyone's hair is different. But for the most part, that's been my experience with hair. Because sometimes someone would say, oh, I want like 50% of my hair cut. And I feel like I cut 50%, but I was kind of being conservative. And then when I dry his hair, I'm just like, bro, I should have cut more. And then this side, I'm doing the same thing, just following from my guide on right here. And this is going to be my second guide in the front right here. So all I'm really doing is just connecting those two guides. And the more drastic this shape is, like the more triangular the shape is, the more volume you really create in the front. And that's either good or bad, depending on what your client wants. Like if your client really wants a really styled haircut, I would try to keep as much volume in the front versus if they just want to really not really style their hair every day. They just want to slick it back and have it lay more flat. I wouldn't create too drastic of a triangle. And now lastly, all I'm going to do is just bring up the section in the middle and connect those two points. And roughly, it should be pretty much the same when done right. There might be a little uneven points, and that's really This just really double checks your work with that. So I'm just connecting everything. Right there. And then this is going to be the last section I connect. Now I'm just going to comb it back. And now I'm just going to apply some product in his hair. I prefer to apply it wet. I just feel like it gets in the roots better. And even sometimes I do a mixture of applying like some of my product wet. And then when it's dry, apply a little bit more, depending if I feel it needs it or not. All those little changes gives the haircut a different touch. Oh, just going to rub it in my hands, make sure it's really dissolved. And just really get it to the roots of his hair. And as I'm doing this, I'm also like prepping his hair and seeing how I want to style it. So right here, I'm just combing through it with my fingers, seeing how much texture just naturally is created, and seeing how much shine the product is giving his hair, how much density it's adding to his hair, if it is adding any. And then from here, I'm just gonna blow dry his hair with medium heat, low speed. And when styling and blow drying hair, this is my favorite brush to use. I feel like it gives the hair a really good grip and you're able to really control how you style the hair when you're using it. And already you kind of start to see the style of the haircut come into life. And I always like to cut with scissors first prior to like using my clippers. I just feel like it makes more sense if I'm going to wet the hair. Might as well do that first, cut it, dry it, and then cut it again. Instead of like cutting it dry, wetting it, and then drying it a second time. It just makes my workflow easier. And I know everyone's different. Not everyone like prefers to do that. Some people, they might see the haircut better or work with the haircut better doing it dry, wet, and then dry again, or even cutting the hair completely dry and cutting it that way. Everyone has their own way of cutting hair. And also when I'm blow drying here, I like to start with the sides first, just because I feel like with the top it kind of takes the longest to dry. So I would want to work with the sides, dry that quickly as the top is slowly drying, and then go back over the top and really style the top afterwards. And also when I'm blow drying, I do like to take my time blow drying and making sure the hair is like thoroughly dry. I just feel like it gives you the most ability to really style the hair you want doing it that way, instead of just trying to rush through it. With proper blow drying, it really does take some time. And to me, when it comes to the size of his head, I feel like the back portion in this area really takes the longest to dry. And then the top takes even longer to dry than that. That's why I work right side, then left side, and then the back of his head. And then it's really saving that top portion for last. Because even in here, it's still taking a little while to dry. Trying to make sure I really thoroughly get in there. And I'm not too focused on styling at the moment. I'm just trying to make sure his hair is thoroughly dry. That makes it a lot easier to style later on. So once that's appropriately dried, now I'm going to work on the top. You really want to create a lot of volume in any haircut. I always recommend grabbing the hair and really drying it roots to end. And just really taking your time doing this. For this haircut, I'm not going to create too much volume in the front. I want it to be more subtle. So I'm just going to add a little bit of volume. Nothing too drastic. I'm gonna hit this side with the same amount of volume roughly. And you see right in here, I really can create a lot of volume with his hair specifically. But I'm not really gonna go for that look. Right now I'm really just trying to dry in the roots towards the top. And now I'm just gonna come back down and really flatten that out so it's not too much volume. So now I'm just feeling through his hair, making sure it's dry from like really roots to end. I feel like there's still a little bit of wetness and dampness in the center right here. So I'm just going to really try to get that out. And now that once I did, now I'm going to really try to focus on the styling aspect of his hair. I'm gonna blow dry everything back from the sides and really make just the two ends in the back right here collide, creating like a more unique shape with the styling. And then with the top, I'm gonna keep it roughly how it is right here. I kind of like it. I like the amount of movement it has currently, and the volume is good enough for me. So as I'm starting to blow dry the back, you could start to see the what I was talking about coming in right there. And if you even want to, you can make it more drastic and just bring it to this side, make it collide right here. It's really up to you. For me, I want it to be a little bit more symmetrical. I'm just gonna bring it in from the other side and just do the same thing. right here. And now I'm just gonna go in with my hands, giving it a more natural look with the same rough shape.
Question, what products do you prefer for this style? Like, I know you kind of talked about what you put in there, but I know you have some ones that you love too.
So for me, there's no real product that I truly prefer, but when it comes to like product and hair, I feel like it really depends on the client. So depending on how oily the person's scalp naturally is, how dry their scalp naturally is, how shiny their hair naturally is, or like how much movement, how much texture it naturally has, from there I would go off of that. If I want to look with more texture and he already has a lot of natural texture, I may add like a little bit of texture with like a clay product and then add a pomade with like more pomade to kind of balance it out. That way, when I put the clay in his hair, it adds some texture, but I also get some moisture from the pomade, so his hair doesn't look too dry, and it gives it a nice balance of both.
Okay.
That's a really good question, I would say.
But that is.
Typically, with products, it really depends on the client's hair, you know, because if you add a clay product to one person's hair and another person's hair, it could look completely different. And all you did is add clay. So,
yeah,
I would definitely keep that in mind. Now I'm just really going to start fading out the temple area and the back of his nape. Right now I'm just making a rough guide with my clippers. I used this is equivalent to like a 2.5-3 guard, so I use that in this area. I know right here I could softly blend that out with scissors. I'm gonna do the same thing on the other side, right here. Just give myself enough room to create a nice blend, but also enough room to really blend into the scissor work, and then turn them around. And then in the back area, I'm going to be doing the same thing. As you can see, his hair naturally has a growth pattern that's like going in this direction, right? So as I'm making my guide, I'm really going to come in from here and give myself just enough room to create a blend. And as I'm creating this area for fading, I also want to keep in mind I still need some area to blend into my scissor work, so I don't want to go too high but I don't want to go too low either to the point where I don't have any room to really create the fade I'm looking to create.
I think that's something that I'm trying to get better at is
the
being aware of how drastic I want that fade to be.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, even like with my son's hair the other day, I'm getting good after watching you for so many weeks. Like,
yeah,
I'm getting good at cutting so close, like scalp it, like to the scalp, like with a trimmer.
Yeah.
Fading in from even like the balder, but that transition, the gradient and how quick that transition happens. That's where I struggle. So like, I like when you're talking about, kind of having enough room to do the fade.
Yeah. So, I would say that really depends on the client's hair and, how thick it is, how dark it is. And I would say a general rule of thumb when it comes to like having enough room, I would say use three fingers like this. If you have three fingers worth of room, you're typically good enough to really stretch that fade out as much as you need to, but, also not like overstretching it out to the point where it just looks like skin, and then hair.
Yeah, exactly.
And right here, I'm just coming in with some scissor over comb, blending out that area. And you can see how nicely it just works with that guard. If he was going for a more like gentleman's haircut, like that would be blended enough and pretty satisfied with it. But I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. And when it comes to fading, I kind of learned a new technique recently that I'll show you guys that really helped me fade a lot more efficiently with a lot less room for error, especially in the lower parts of the fade, like getting closer to the skin. What I started to do, I really stayed away from making a line with my trimmers. I feel like that makes it a lot easier to blend into. Because from that point, like right here, I'll create a small...
You turn him a little bit?
I created a small guide right here.
Okay.
With just skin. And I made it big enough so that I know from here, I'm just going to blend down from my clipper closed, right? That's my initial guide. Now I'm going to blend down with my trimmer. And this part, you don't really see much of a difference, but there is a very subtle difference. And then from here, I'm going to use my foil shaver and just blend that out right here. So I know from there, when it comes to my clipper close to my foil shaver, all this is already blended. I don't have to worry about it. So from here, it's just like, you know, blending with from your clipper close to your clipper open. And there's still no line, like, at all.
And that's a good tip.
Yeah.
Because I've been doing the trimmer.
Yeah. Like,
and creating the line. I like creating the line that way, though, a lot.
For me, that concept really came from... the idea of not creating a hard line with your trimmers, right?
Yeah.
And I always told myself, like, when I try going in with the trimmers and creating a line, like, this way, I can't really get a very solid and accurate line.
Yeah.
So now, with my clipper closed, I feel like I still could get a very solid and accurate line. And it makes it easy to create that line and easy to blend into that line. And then from there, it's like, I would say blending into your blade closed is a lot easier than blending into like a trimmer line that you created for most people.
Right.
And then from there, I just created a guide with my one. And now I'm just using this guard again to really blend back into that bulk. And this is the first guard I used to create that initial line. So right now, I just know I'm really blending into what I initially created. And just like that, I feel like it's made my fading a lot faster and a lot more efficient. And just a lot easier for me to do and understand, which makes it come out better. Because I'm basically done in like 2 minutes. And I still could go back over it and detail it. Like, I'm not completely done. But I would say the rough draft of my fade is finished.
Yeah, that was quick.
So I'm going to do the same thing on this side. You notice I create a nice, strong line with my clipper close. Right there. Now I'm just going to go in with my trimmers and kind of take out whatever I see is a little bit darker until it's blended. And as you can see, like right here, I'm really using my corners. And the main reason is because I don't have enough room in like this area for fade. If I was fading his whole head, I wouldn't have to use the corners as much. And then like right here, I'm just going to blend into it with my foil shaver. So I know all that is as low as it possibly could be. And now I just have to work through that same process again. Blade open. Just close my clipper and should blend out pretty easily. You know, with some people it's harder, for some people it's easier. Everyone's head is different. And even with some people, like the left side of their head might be harder to fade than the right, just because no one's head is like perfectly symmetrical when it comes to like density of their hair or shape of their head. But I just blend it into my clipper close. Now I'm using my wand, creating a guide. Using my half to blend in between the one and the one open and the blade open. And I gotta say, to me, I feel like this half guard is like the most inconsistent guard like ever made. Like there was a point where I wasn't even using it and I was just like trying to fade with my clipper open into a one close, just because I felt like that half guard was so inconsistent. It wasn't like a true half. Like your blade open to me is a little bit longer than an actual half guard. And the half open is a little bit longer than the one guard close. So like also when it comes to fading with that half guard, I would say keep that in mind. And also it really depends on how you set your clippers. Like everyone's clippers are set differently. So for you, it might be vice versa depending on how close or how gapped you have your clippers. And I know for me, when it comes to my clippers, I like having them like my clippers themselves as close as possible, just like a little bit of room, just so that it makes it a lot easier to blend into skin. And I guess that's another reason why this method works so well for me. I know each one of my clippers, I know like how close they are apart from each other, so it makes it a lot easier to blend. Because I do have two trimmers, but I'm choosing to use that trimmer instead of my other trimmer because I know that one just blends better with my clipper closed. So I would say take all that into consideration and also pay attention to your tools and how you have them set. If you understand how you have them set, it makes it a lot easier to work with them. And when I start to work in the back, I'm going to show you what I mean with three fingers being like a average guide for most fades. So when you get to the back, I'd say typically you use three fingers, right? So I'm gonna start my bald line at the bottom of my first finger, right there. And it doesn't have to be 100% accurate, you know, it's just like a rough estimate. Everyone's head's different. And then go in right here with the trimmers and just blend down like I did previously. Do you have a small like paper towel or something?
Yes.
So I'm just going to use a little piece of this paper towel just because bleeding like a little bit. I gave him a little nick right here. Yeah, it's like a small little pimple. But the main reason I really want to clean that is because I know I'm using this and this gets extremely close. So I didn't want to cut close on top of somewhere that's already cut. You're going to just see me work around it and kind of reduce the bleeding as much as possible.
It stops quick.
Yeah.
Usually.
And, like, with hair cutting, it's kind of, like, bound to happen, especially, like, if someone has, like, you know, a pimple or something. And you got to kind of learn how to really work around it until it stops because there's nothing you really could do, in a sense.
People watching that, like, it's probably happened. They didn't even know.
Yeah.
Because, like, usually I'll be working around it, and then it stops by the time you're done. Like, it's already pretty much stopped.
So now, that's my first finger, right? So now I'll create a guide with the blade open about fingers width. Right there. And just blend that out. And then for my next guide, it's going to be the one guard open, fingers width, again, like right here. And the principle of that is basically each one of like your main guards, I would say like the blade open one and two open or three closed, whatever you kind of prefer to fade with, would fall into those segments. Because typically, I would say 90% of people fade that with, like, you know, that number system going from blade open to one open. I know some people have different preferences. They might go blade closed. I mean, blade open to, like, a one closed. But I would just say kind of keep that in the back of your mind if you're having trouble trying to figure out how much space you need for your fade. And then with my last finger, that's basically how much room I need to really blend into that bulk right here. So I'm going to take my biggest guard that I was using, the same guard I used to create my guide, and kind of clean that up right here. And now I'm just going to my 1.5 guard open. So I completely blend out this area right here. And from here, I'm actually going to use clipper over comb instead of scissor over comb, just because this area, like the back of someone's head, typically is a lot heavier than the sides. So I know, like, I could use scissor over comb, but I feel like it's just going to take me a little bit longer. So what I'm going to do, I'm not using a clipper comb. Actually, I'm just using a smaller comb. I feel like it works better for me. Let me get a good angle for you guys. So I'm just going to scoop up the hair and kind of come off on an angle. And with my clipper open, not closed, with my clipper open, I'll just scoop out whatever sticks out just like that. And you could see, when I was cutting initially with the scissors, right, I made my sections in this direction. So to help blend my clipper work in, I'm going to pull out that hair in the same direction and just cut accordingly. And I don't know if anyone noticed, but as I was cutting with the scissors, I wasn't too precise in this area. And the main reason why is because I knew I was going to go back over it with a clipper over comb, scissor over comb. So I wasn't too worried. As long as I had the general shape outlined, I knew I'd be okay. That kind of comes from just experience. Like, the more you do your own system, or, you know, cut hair the same way, you kind of notice, like, okay, that area, like, I'm going over it now, but I might be going over it again regardless. So it's okay if it's, like, a little sloppy compared to taking your time. So right here, I'm going to be doing the same exact thing. Just pulling out the hair, taking out whatever I need to take out. And there's still some inconsistencies, but to me it's okay because I could go over it with scissor over comb just to really refine that area. And right here, I'm really working against like a growth pattern. So I definitely have to keep that in mind and work with it instead of trying to work against it, which is why I'm coming at it from a semi different angle from before. It's still roughly the same, but I'm just trying to attack it a little differently. Instead of coming at it this way, I'm just gonna blend at it like you would with a scissor over comb. So then from here, I know this area right here, I could just blend that out with some thinning shears. Right here, you guys can probably see the best. So I'll just go in there, soften that up. And to me, I really love thinning shears that don't really take out too much hair. Like, you could really just keep going in and in until you really get it how you want it to be. Compared to if it was something stronger, you might take out too much at once or more than you were really expecting to. And then from there, it's like you gotta really work from it, like work with it to make it look how you want it to look instead of just doing that initially. So from here, I'm just gonna line him up now. Where I put my brush? Right here. Yeah, now I'm just gonna line him up. I typically like to start from just this side of his head naturally. So I'm just going to brush out all the hair that may fall over this line and create my line from wherever I feel like it's the strongest point. So for me, I feel like if I were to create it, you know, real soft right here, that would be extremely natural, but it won't be too defined. So instead, I'm going to cut off like a tiny portion of it right here and attack it from this angle to really keep a nice balance of like a real natural line, but it's also very defined. I'll just do that right there. And then from here, this has always been like one of the things that kind of took me a lot of work on to really get a nice C shape in this section of the lineup. I always like to start with just creating a small straight line right here at the top corner. And then another one inwards from like the top of the beard. Just enough so I can have a good gauge of where I want the lines to start and end. And once I have that, I'll just connect the two pieces. Right there, just like that. And really use the corner of my trimmer to do so. And I'm not too worried about it being too defined. As long as the shape is there, that's good, because I'll always go back over with my razor and clean that up. And just repeat the same process on this side. And as you can see, this side of his hairline is just naturally stronger. I won't have to really tap it at all to get a strong line. And that also comes into play what I was saying earlier, like, you know, naturally someone's head might be easier on one side than the other, and that applies to like all aspects of the haircut.
Hey Ryan, I'm gonna move your...
Oh, there we go.
There you go.
Now I'll just do the same thing I was saying earlier on this side, hit the top corner, hit the bottom piece, and then just curve it, just like that. And I feel like this part takes a little bit of practice to really get that nice curve motion with your hands. And now from here, I'm just gonna do the beard. I want to keep it more of a natural look, so I'm just going to blend in the top of his beard. So what I'll do, I'll just come in at an angle. So when I'm doing it, my clipper is at this angle. It's not straight, it's not flat, or it's not like all the way out. Just like on a subtle angle, I'll just blend it this way. And it creates like a natural fading effect. So now I know I don't really have to do much. I just have to blend out the top piece, top portion, right there. And really just go in with a clipper over comb at a decent angle and blend it out. I just want to show you guys a little different technique that you probably don't see too often. And you could always go back in detail. So like for me, that's just like a rough draft. And on this side, I'm not going to do the same thing just because I'm right-handed. So for me, it's a little bit easier if I just go in and scoop out a little bit of at a time. And I would say this is a good technique to learn just because it helps you with fading. So like, I would say if you're able to fade like this, like with using no guards, when you do use guards, it makes it a lot easier to fade in between those guards because you're paying more attention to the lightness and darkness in certain spots rather than the actual length of hair. Turn straight for me. Oh, yeah. You good. So now from here, typically I would have to clean it up a little bit on that on the beard. So I'll just use my one guard and just blend out whatever is like inconsistent. And I'm just gonna go back and blow dry it with cold air. And I love styling with my fingers. I feel like it just gives it a more of a natural, free-flowing look, at least if that's what you want to go for. Some styles, some haircuts, you might feel like it suits it better more with a very structured style instead of more natural flowing. But with me, I feel like this haircut really gets complimented by that. And that's pretty much it. I'm just going to clean off like his neck and stuff like that. That's pretty much it. Did you guys have any last questions while I'm finishing up?
So, no, they're just shouting. They're saying, looks nice. Oh, looks thank good.
You. From here, you could just play with it, depending on however you want to style it, however he wants to style it. I know he'll probably mess with it, you know, style it his own way later on, but that's it, you guys.
Looks good. All right, guys, cool. Thanks for hanging out with us in the chat and being a part of the live stream. If you guys want to know when the upcoming live streams are, just make sure you subscribe to the YouTube channel. And anytime we're going live, you will see in your feed when we schedule it, or you'll get an alert when we go live as long as you hit those notification bells for the channel. So that's it. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Reed. Looking good. And go follow Ryan. I think I actually have your Instagram.
I actually changed it recently.
Did you really?
Yeah, I just changed it to my name just to make it easier.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Oh, very official.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, cool. Well, I don't have that one yet, but go follow Ryan Henney.
Yeah. Ryan Henney with an underscore, and it's Henney with an EY at the end, not like the drink. A lot of people get that mixed up. Yeah.
Okay. All right. All right, cool. Thank you, guys. We'll see you on the next stream.
Right. Thank you, guys. Peace. Was that for...
There's a few things that you have to understand about haircutting before you can really jump into doing haircuts. These are all things that I'm going to teach you guys in the next 8 haircuts. Truly understanding the why behind what you're doing in haircutting can make haircutting so much more fun and make you way more successful behind the chair.